We've got a sun-drenched day in the Twin Cities, 75 degrees. It's a Sports Sunday. Eric Nelson with you at 5:07 in the Central Time Zone. TC Chris Elston is our studio coordinator. And in the newsroom is the iconic Steve Murphy. If anything breaks, he will sprint down the hallway like Usain Bolt. Open a mic and tell us what's happening.
When do I get iconic status? Just out of curiosity.
You're a long ways away from the icon status.
Okay.
I don't even think you're close to legendary yet.
Oh, really?
I think icon has replaced legendary in jargon these days. But
I'm working at it.
Yeah, you're getting there, though. Okay. You keep chopping wood, you never know what's going to happen.
I'm still kind of in the journeyman mode.
Yes.
Yeah, bummer.
Yes. But you're starting to prove yourself more and more. Your effort yesterday out there at River Center at the Starkey Gala was noticed by many. Facebook Nation, yeah. Twitterverse, blogosphere.
That's because
they are blowing up.
I'm really good at self-promotion, that's why.
And that's what this world has come to. Before we get to our in-house guest this hour, I want to get you updated on the Twins game today. They lose at Fenway. Boston 6, Minnesota 4, so the Twins win 3 out of 4 in New England, but the Red Sox avoid the sweep today. Red Sox 6 runs, 14 hits, no errors. Minnesota 4-6-0. Morales the winner, Blackburn the loser. Acevis his 23rd save of the year for Boston. Josh Willingham, home run number 28 for Minnesota. Ryan Domet his 11th. Adrian Gonzalez also hit number 11 for the Bo Sox. Twins are 47-61 on the year. Red Sox are 54-55. All right. In the house, trying to survive jet lag, our good friend Rasheeni Rajkumar. We're going to talk some sports gossip, who's hot, who's not in the Olympics, a lot of great stuff. How you doing, Rasheeni?
I am doing well, and thank you, Eric and Chris, for accepting the fact I'm a little dressed down today. I'm recovering from about 30 hours or more between airports in a couple different countries and planes, the toughest of which was probably a 10-hour layover in Doha, Qatar, in the Middle East. So I landed there Friday night at about 11 p.m. Qatar time and left at 9 a.m. Qatar time, which of course was still Friday night here in Minneapolis, but it was already Saturday morning there. And while I flew for 15 hours to Houston, you could say I saw Saturday twice because I landed after a 15-hour flight, leaving at 9 a.m. Qatar, 4:45 p.m. Houston, Texas. So and then I still had to get back to Minneapolis.
So a 3-day weekend. Congratulations.
Exactly.
And by the way, you look good. You don't look like you have jet lag. And you aren't dressed down because next to Chris and I, you always are dressed up.
Well, thank you. Well, it's fun to be here. Always great to see Murph in the newsroom. So that was an added bonus. But, you know, what was interesting about being in Malaysia beyond the work I was doing there was really reflecting on and watching the Olympics. You know, not being able to see it right as it was happening, that was a little removed for me because I was working in also the time differences, but I would wake up every morning and go to bed every night with the Olympics on in my hotel room between ESPN and BBC World, actually. So those were the two English-speaking channels in my hotel room. So it was really fun, and then I was getting news flashes from the Washington Post on my phone about Phelps' various medals, so I felt pretty up to date. But it was interesting watching it from an Asian perspective. You know, being the big fan of the U.S. team that I was, and of course in Malaysia they were doing various profiles of their athletes and other Asian athletes. The China was at the volleyball team, you know, some controversy there, learning also more about how gold is the only important thing to the Chinese athletes, not even to China, the country, maybe not the athletes, not even silver and bronze. So that was all really interesting, receiving that from the Malaysian perspective.
And by the way, the medal update, China is on top, 61 medals for the Chinese, 30 golds. The USA right behind with 60 medals, 28 golds. And Great Britain, the home country, the host country, 37 medals, 16 golds. But
quite the battle there. And you know what, Rasheeni, it's interesting you'd say that because when I watched the opening ceremonies, it really struck me, you know, and it's American of us, and I'm very proud of America and to be an American and to watch this happen. But as you're watching other countries, you see all these very small countries, Ghana's coming through and, you know, all these Botswana, and they've got, you know, this smaller population. They've got 5 representatives or 8 representatives in the Olympics. That's
right.
It. That's all the Olympians they have.
Doesn't it make you feel proud?
Yeah. Well, then to see America, here's 530 Olympians, you
right.
know, so we're going there to take it all. And I wonder if we feel the level of pride that somebody from Botswana you know, they've got eight people there. If they win one medal, I mean, that's probably,
well, I think it's pretty huge.
Probably not. Pretty
I
big.
Think it's pretty huge, and I think in the U.S. we've almost just sort of accepted. I mean, like, it would be shocking if the U.S. men's basketball team didn't get to the gold round. You know, I mean, that would just be shocking. And actually, I woke up one morning to the U.S. men's team playing Tunisia, and they were not doing well in that first quarter. Now, they picked it up, but it was really interesting to see that, and I thought, wow, if we go down to Tunisia, that would not look good.
No. Kobe Bryant said before the Olympics, if we don't bring back the gold, take away our citizenship.
Well, and aren't most of the other teams, or has it changed, Eric? Remember when in basketball they had to be below the professional level?
Right, they were amateurs.
And is that still the case for other countries, or is it getting more and more professional?
No, they can bring in whoever they want. I mean, you have a lot of NBA guys who are from France or Germany or Argentina. That
and
are
some of the guys
teams.
Go back and play for their countries.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I agree with Kobe's line on that one then. You know?
Yeah, and to Chris's point, with Usain Bolt winning another 100-meter dash, record 9.63 seconds today in London, in a place like Jamaica, they have to be swelling with pride.
Absolutely.
That is, you know, it's their Super Bowl, it's their World Cup, whatever you want to call it. This guy doing this is unbelievable.
Well, and don't you think there are some athletes that are at this point, iconic, I would say, Chris, to use your favorite term of the day. Usain Bolt, regardless of his country, we can all get behind him. Just like Pele with soccer, you know, there are some athletes that we can just all get behind.
Actually, trending right now on Twitter, and it's not hard to find. There, it's the Usain Bolt pose. If you remember when everybody was Tebowing last
year. That's right.
That's the new thing. So you're doing, like, I'm demonstrating in the studio. I don't really know what the pose is, but that's the pose with the one hand up. It's kind of the elevated Heisman.
And we won't be taking any pictures and putting that on Twitter.
No, no. Actually, think during the break, we are all going to bolt it up here in the studio.
Excellent.
And we'll get it up on
Hey, you and I were on the webpage plenty yesterday at the Starkey Gala.
I'm addicted.
We don't need to be on it anymore.
Well, speaking of Twitter, though, I'm glad Chris brought that up because I wanted to give some Twitter advice, and I was going to save it to the end. But as long as he brought it up and he was talking about what's trending, you know, I hope people are on Twitter, and I hope they're following WCCO Radio. That's at WCCO Radio. But some other ones I recommend, especially right now with the Olympics, at Olympics, that's for the regular Olympics, that's the official site, and then at U.S. Olympic, which is not plural, which is the official Twitter site for the Olympic team, the U.S. Olympic team. And then you had the NFL guy on earlier, Eric, and I would definitely recommend at NFL Network, of course, at Twins, and another one just for all of you Minnesota people, at MN Today. Now, Eric, I could not find you on Twitter. Are you on there, buddy?
I'm not in the Twitterverse.
I didn't think so because there were all these Eric Nelsons.
Now you're gonna get
None
me
of
in
them
trouble.
Looked like you. They were not as good looking as you. And you need to be on there.
Well, you can coach me up when we're done.
Okay.
I need a lot of help in that department.
Now, this is the second time in 2 days, Eric, that you've been called out on the air
for not being
I'm going to be blunt here. I just don't know why anyone would care about my random thoughts. That's my feeling.
It's not random thoughts, though. I mean, it's a time for you to talk about sports. You can put your unique angle. I happen to. It was really fun.
So I could sit and vent about having a retractable roof stadium if I want?
You could.
It's another forum for me?
I would try to have. I would try to really do some productive commentary. But for instance, it was my lifeline while I was in Malaysia. I did some tweets out to the U.S. Olympic team. I felt like I could say, go USA, Team USA, from Malaysia. And anyone who cared, which are the people following me, I'm not saying they all care either. But the point is, I could share that. And I could do some shout outs to the U.S.
But
Olympic
team. You're good at that. You're hip. I mean, you're with everything.
And speaking of hip, I wanted to recommend David Beckham, but there is no official site for David Beckham.
He didn't even make the soccer team in the UK.
It's official when there's a little blue check mark after it. Now, her husband, his wife has her own official Victoria Beckham, which appears to be official. So if you want to get a little bit of late breaking David Beckham news, you may be able to get it at Victoria Beckham. But I was
Spice Girls news.
Right. Spice Girls news, which Chris follows.
Yeah,
but I was troubled that David Beckham doesn't have his own site. Now, there are plenty of David Beckham sites out there, but they're not official. So you don't
and
know
And you
who's
have hit
it.
Them all multiple times.
No. I don't follow
sure.
any of them because they're not the official
all
site.
Right. Well, now that we're talking about the Twitterverse. Give me your thoughts on this. Jimbo Fisher, head football coach, Florida State, the other day said, no more of my guys are going on Twitter because one of their players said something that they regret.
Right.
Jim Mora, the coach at UCLA, has basically said no cell phones while they're at their training camp. Is that where we're going?
Well, I don't know why we'd have to go there. I mean, first of all, some of the NFL players, a la Brett Favre, are not necessarily always doing good things on Twitter. So short of sending any, you know, pictures that shouldn't be on Twitter, I would say be on Twitter if it's about doing something productive and furthering the conversation. But if you're doing something destructive or truly gossiping and you are an official member of a team, then that's not what I would recommend.
All right, there you go.
Can coaches, though, and particularly now you're talking about college, and that's one thing. I don't think you'd ever see a professional coach try this. I just don't even know. Is there any way? Aren't we trying to, Rashini, define the line between, you know, really what they can do? I mean, can a coach say, hey, you can't be on Twitter? I mean,
well, it's probably in the player's contract, and we're talking pro sports now, that says you can't do anything to defame your team. Conduct unbecoming. And if a coach determines that this is just letting you out there a little too loosely. Now, the better way to go is having some policy at the beginning. I think last time I was in, Eric, we talked about these different leagues and different teams giving their players some media coaching, and right along with that, social media coaching, because it can be a really cool tool to use for these players to directly speak with their fans. And that's really the point of Twitter. It's not to stir things up. It's not to put gossip and lies out there. It's really about connecting with your fans and that authentic voice. But, and that's why I only, with David Beckham, only want the official site. So I won't follow those other, you know, whatever they are, wannabes that are saying they're David Beckham's official site or they're the fan following. I want to hear from him, or I don't want to hear from it at all.
We have seen, though, how it can take a negative turn, how a spark can become a forest fire instantly. I remember when Jay Cutler pulled himself out of the NFC Championship game against Green Bay a couple of years ago. And immediately, Twitterverse blogosphere blew up, people saying Jay Cutler's soft. He should have been in there playing for the right to go to the Super Bowl. Even NFL players like Mojo Drew ripped him on Twitter. And it's kind of since come out where, hey, Jay Cutler was hurt. And he's not soft. He's a diabetic playing in the NFL.
Right.
So I think you always got to remember when you hit the send button, it's out there for good.
Exactly.
You have to be careful.
You've got to be careful. You've got to not only edit for typos and grammar and swear words, but what you've got to do is really ask yourself, do I want to push send on this? And there is nothing that's confidential once it goes on the web, especially Twitter or Facebook. So don't, even though there are protections and only your friends can read this, it can be found. So I would never put something out there unless you're truly ready to deal with any and all repercussions.
I wonder about the risk reward, though. I mean, maybe coaches, Eric, like you say, the Jay Cutler situation, I'm sure those kind of things put them a little bit on edge. However, I think the David Sterns and the Roger Goodells of the world, you know, the commissioners of the NFL, the NBA, Major League Baseball, they have to embrace this, because I think they love it. Because when I saw the opening ceremonies, again, to go back to London, and LeBron James is coming out and he's taking pictures and taking video with his cell phone, he was doing that to put it on his Twitter account. So here you have this unlimited access. If you're a fan of LeBron, if you follow him and you check and see what he's saying every day, you just got to look at what it looks like to walk out of the tunnel and walk through the Parade of Nations from LeBron James' standpoint. If you're David Stern, I mean, this is bringing your players or your fans so much closer to the players than they've ever been able to do. I think that the risk reward is to say to these professionals, do it.
And do it
be
well.
On Twitter.
Yeah, and LeBron James is such a businessman. You know, he is such a great businessman, and that is very smart. And my guess is he is putting quality stuff out there. You know, he wouldn't let something out there that would damage his reputation or his team's reputation.
Well, and it is the world we live in. I mean, those of us resistant to it have to admit that is the way it is. It has changed, and I think we're all smart if we adapt to the changing times. I know that probably back when the founding fathers drew up the Constitution and they said the right to free speech, they probably weren't thinking about somebody tweeting or writing a blog.
I mean, how much easier would Paul Revere's job would have been so much easier if
to
he
tweet,
had Twitter.
Yeah. At Paul Revere.
Yeah.
At Midnight Ride.
One lantern this. Two lanterns.
The British are coming. I'm going to ride. More with Rashini coming up on WCCO.
WCCO.com. It's
And that's a fitting song for today. Nothing but blue skies, plenty of sunshine, 75 degrees. It's a Sports Sunday. Eric Nelson with you. Rashini Rajkumar in the house as we talk sports trends, sports gossip, sports marketing, Twitterverse, blogosphere, all that good stuff between now and 6 o'clock. And, of course, we had a huge event on these airwaves last night, Rashini.
Yes, you and Jordana covering the Starkey Foundation Gala, the annual gala. It's amazing every year, the celebs, the A-list celebs that Starkey brings in. I mean, I, of course, because I was out of the country, as you know, and I was flying back while you guys were covering this, where did I get my news? The WCCO Facebook page. So I got those pictures, see these different people, Marley Matlin, Chevy Chase, Billy Crystal, a nice appearance from Lou Ferrigno. It's yeah. always fun to see him. Now, on the plane going to Malaysia, Eric, I watched the Avengers, and the guy they had playing Mark Ruffalo, however you say his last name, played the Hulk in that. But I'm saying, you know, back to my childhood, there's no one like Lou Ferrigno. He was the original
yeah,
Hulk.
The original Green Man.
Right.
Yeah, and he, I had a chance to talk to him briefly as he came down the red carpet, shook his hand, and he seemed like a genuine guy. It's hard to really know in a two-minute conversation, but he really seemed real. He was friendly. And he did work out yesterday. He confirmed that.
Yeah. it was really cool to see all those people. Steve Martin, Buzz Aldrin. My goodness. I mean, such a great event. And I'm so glad you both got to cover that. But I just have a little communication presentation advice for a couple of the celebrities. Do you want to hear my take?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I thought Marley Matlin looked beautiful as ever. Okay. Steve Martin, looking good. He must be, what, mid-60s at this point? He's looking
yeah,
really good.
Very fit.
Right. Lou Ferrigno looking good. Buzz Aldrin looking good. I was a little disappointed with Chevy Chase and Billy Crystal. You know, I want him to drop a few pounds. What was your take live? These were just the photos that I saw.
Chevy's a little heavy. If
yeah.
you'll pardon the
well,
pun.
Well, I saw a side view of Billy Crystal, so it could have just been a bad
and
chin
Chevy
angle.
Spoke at the event. Okay. And I don't think he had any notes.
Okay.
He tended to ramble a bit.
He did ramble.
But Billy Crystal looks a little bit older.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Of course, they're getting older. I mean, that's the reality
right.
of it.
I think yeah. I just want him to still look like when Harry met
right.
Sally.
Well, know? That's the problem when you're famous on the big screen or
right.
on the tube. As you age and you go back and watch the old stuff, and we all do, it's like, wow, look at him now compared to then. I mean, I asked Lou Ferrigno about Carrie Heffernan because I'm a big King of Queens guy.
Yeah.
I said, what's Carrie like? Is she cool? He said, oh, yeah, she's great. Now, most people think of the Incredible Hulk like you do.
Yeah,
I was
exactly.
thinking of King of Queens where he had a bit role.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't even know if I saw that.
Can I ask you about one? Because there was one that stood out to me, and since you're here, I want to get your opinion on this. I'll put this up on the Facebook page. I don't think it's up there now, but I will put it up here during the next break. But right now, I want to show it to you, Rashini, and tell
okay.
me about this person.
Okay.
This is Billy Ray Cyrus.
Oh, my goodness.
Billy Ray Cyrus showed up yesterday. We all remember Billy Ray Cyrus's iconic mullet from the
yeah.
90s when he had Achy Breaky Heart. He showed up yesterday, and this is how he looked. If you can see it from over there, there's
yeah,
a strange necklace. The hair is
a weird neckline, and his jacket's a little big. It's just kind of hanging on him.
So this is a guy who has to overcome an image that he had kind of set for himself before. Is he doing a good job of that?
You know, I don't know, unless he's just really trying to change the look, you know, get us anti-mullet, not talking about that mullet anymore. But there was a time when he was quite a good-looking guy. I mean, you know, minus the mullet. He was quite a good-looking guy, but he's had a rough couple years. I will say, personal life, family life. So who knows what's happening behind the scenes?
Well, you know why it's been rough for him? He confirmed to us yesterday he's a huge Minnesota Vikings fan.
Oh, my gosh.
And they're
that
coming off six
it.
Wins and three wins in the last 2 years. So that's been rough on him.
Yeah.
But he did say he'd like to sing the Star Spangled Banner when they christen the new stadium in 2016.
What do you think? Do you think that's a reality?
I think he'd have a chance.
I think they'd get somebody bigger.
Do you think so?
I'm positive. Wouldn't yeah. they? This is the Viking Stadium.
I would hope so.
Probably going to be somebody local. You know what I'm saying, with Minnesota roots.
What about Prince?
I was just going to bring up Prince.
I mean, it doesn't really seem like a song Prince would sing, but he would rock
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he'd figure a way to get it done.
He would rock it. And I mean, purple. That's his color.
Yeah, Purple Rain.
It just works.
Purple Mountain Majesty.
Maybe Dylan.
Jimi Hendrix did the best ever, and he's been compared to Jimmy
That's
on
right.
guitar.
Bob Dylan would have to get some votes.
Oh, Bob
he's
Dylan.
He's still going strong.
What about a duet, those two?
Now, that would be fun. That would
I want
be
to
fun.
See it at the very least at the Grammys next
And let's
year.
Hope that Minneapolis wouldn't do what they did in London at Hyde Park, where Springsteen and McCartney were having a concert a couple of minutes after the curfew, and they pulled the plug on it. They went silent.